Hello, friends and scholars. In this video log today, I'm talking about readings of the Gospels of Matthew and Mark and some similarities and differences and questions that come out of the reading and the comparison of those two Gospels. And in both of these Gospels, Jesus is portrayed as having his identity and his mission wrapped up in the idea that he's bringing the kingdom of God to pass in as a physical reality in the present world. And some of the differences are that Mark reads like the 11 o'clock newscast. There's no break in the action ever. There's no hesitating to make commentary or to analyze what's going on. It's just one action-packed adventure after another. Matthew, on the other hand, goes to the effort to make the case that Jesus is a Jewish Messiah and that he's the fulfillment of the Hebrew scriptures and the prophecies. He gives genealogies, and at important events in the life and ministry of Jesus, he intentionally ties those events to specific passages from the Hebrew scripture. This serves as a commentary of its own about what Matthew believes about Jesus as the Christ. Also, in Mark, there's an emphasis that's more on Jesus' actions and less on his words. The healings and the miracles take center stage in the Gospel of Matthew or the Gospel of Mark, whereas in Matthew, there's more of an emphasis on Jesus' words. He's portrayed more as a teacher and less of a healer and miracle worker, although Matthew does recount some of Jesus' miraculous deeds as making his case for Jesus being the Messiah. In Matthew, we get chapter after chapter of Jesus teaching in parables. The Jesus that's portrayed in Mark is enigmatic and obtuse. I described him in Bible study last night as being an enigma wrapped up in a mystery smothered in secret sauce. And when he teaches in parables, he only explains the meaning of the parables to the inner circle of the 12 disciples. People are regularly recorded in Mark as asking the key question, who is this man? The religious authorities ask the question. The civil authorities, Herod and Pilate, ask, who is this man? The disciples, after Jesus calms the storm, say, who is this man that the wind and the seas obey him? And even the crowds who follow Jesus are left questioning, who is this man who heals, who casts out demons, and who teaches with such authority? Matthew retains some elements of the messianic secret, partly because he borrows so much material from the Gospel of Mark. But Jesus in Matthew is less intentionally opaque. He explains the parables, and he gives teachings that the people can use in their everyday life to better fulfill their walk with God and their observance of the Torah. As a healer in Mark, Jesus is much more touchy-feely. He does two miracles that I call, and now Jesus does miracles with spit. He lays his hands on people. When Jesus heals in Mark, it's a combination of what he says and his touch that often brings about the healing miracle. And in Matthew, the emphasis is more on Jesus' words. He does touch people in Matthew, but we get less of those stories that involve spit. After reading Levine's article and watching her YouTube interview, I'm having a little bit of a struggle about how we should teach and preach about the Pharisees and their role in the Gospels. Maybe it's a Western construct that we look at literature and we divide everybody into teams based on who's the antagonist and who's the protagonist in the story. And from within that dichotomy, the Pharisees are obviously portrayed as antagonistic to Jesus. In what might be the nerdiest analogy ever, I see Jesus in the Gospels as being kind of like Professor Xavier in the X-Men, and he's trying to put together this upside-down kingdom of mutants, and just go with me on this. I'm going somewhere with it, really. And the Pharisees are kind of like the people who are trying to squelch out the mutants because they want everybody to conform and be part of acceptable society. And, you know, Peter, because he slices off people's ears, is Wolverine. See, I was going somewhere with that. My theory is that Jesus and the Pharisees both have a similar goal in mind. They want to see the law and tradition of the fathers upheld, and they want to see the Torah fulfilled. And I think the difference is that the Pharisees have turned fulfilling the law down to the very literal letter of it into an end unto itself. This rule following is what makes you righteous. And much like the prophets of the Hebrew scriptures, Jesus criticizes them for rule following at the expense of the weakest members of their society, the widows, the orphans, the outcasts, the poor. I did like what Levine said in the interview about the issue of ritual purity. I think we've kind of told a mythology in our preaching and teaching in the Christian church, especially about the woman in chapter 5 of Mark who has the issue of blood. And we've told this story that because she would be ritually impure, that she's risking her life by coming out into the marketplace and asserting herself in the way that she touches the hem of Jesus' garment and kind of brings her own healing about because of that act of faith. And we see her as being a person who lives in isolation, like in solitary confinement, and lives this horrible life of loneliness and desperation. And the fact of the matter is there's really not any evidence in the scripture that backs up that theory. It could be our misunderstanding of first century Palestinian culture. What I notice is that Jesus does touch people that the Pharisees are not touching. What's different about Jesus is that he's not worried about the uncleanness of these people that he's touching, rendering him impure. Their ritual impurity doesn't contaminate him in the same way that it would contaminate an ordinary person. The thing about being unclean is that there was a remedy for uncleanness. There were sacrifices that could be offered. And in most of the cases, the people that Jesus touches, the dead girl, Jairus' daughter, the woman with the issue of blood, the leper, the demoniac in the cemetery, the remedy is simply that he would be pure the next morning because you were only impure until sunset. So it wouldn't be a big deal that Jesus contracted sin from these people. The difference is that instead of their impurity being transmitted to Jesus, is that his purity is transmitted to them and makes them whole. And I have some other thoughts about that and about how looking at the Pharisees impacts us in the Christian church, but I'm not going to put that on my YouTube video, and I hope that we can get into it in the forum. And I pray that everybody is enjoying this activity, and I can't wait to see everyone else's videos, and I hope you have a blessed week.